world. If true, the entire international aviation safety system is threatened.
The design of these aircraft was not followed. They took shortcuts in the manufacture of these aircraft.
Nobody cared about the safety aspect. It was all about money. It was all about being lean and making parts as inexpensively as possible for Boeing.
We have an agency system, a civil aviation system in our industry that is unfortunately playing Russian roulette with our flying passengers.
For more than 40 years, freight trains have hauled aircraft bodies to Boeing's final assembly factories in Seattle from its construction plant 1,500 miles away in Wichita, Kansas. Gigi Pruitt's family worked for Boeing in Wichita for three generations.
Boeing's my heritage. My mother grew up in between the two plants during the 40s and 30s. This was my mother's backyard as a child. This is where she grew up.
Started working at Boeing in November 21st, 1996. I was hired as a requirement support specialist for procurement. About 3 months later, I believe it is, I was promoted to a buyer.
Gigi Pruitt joined Boeing at a vital point in the company's history. For nearly 20 years, it had produced the world's most popular passenger plane, the 737 Classic Series. On any given day, somewhere in the world, a 737 takes off or lands every 5 seconds. But by 1996, Boeing had lost market share to its European rival, Airbus. To restore its position, the company decided to introduce a new and technologically radical plane to be called the 737 Next Generation, or NG. Previous models were built completely by hand. Parts for the 737 NG were to be designed, cut, and shaped by hugely expensive computer-controlled machines. These would guarantee each piece was precise to within 3/1000ths of an inch, allowing the plane to fly higher and faster. Boeing also designed a new process for fitting these parts together. Advanced Technology Assembly, or ATA, would enable the airframe to slot together as quickly and as accurately as a piece of flat-pack furniture.
This ATA was designed so that the tolerances in putting the airplane together will be so tight that the aircraft will have higher strength and reliability. And in response to that, the FAA certified this airplane to have higher gross weight and to be able to operate at higher altitudes.
Every new aircraft design has to be approved by an official regulatory body. For American aircraft manufacturers like Boeing, the Federal Aviation Administration issues licenses called Type Design Certificates.
The Type Certificate is all of the engineering drawings and test data that you've put together that validate that it's an airplane that can be built and safely operated. Think about these giant airplanes. They're made of thousands of detailed parts, and you have to provide the FAA with all of the drawings for all of those detailed parts and processes that support the manufacture of those parts. Now that's your type design data that you are supposed to follow for every airplane, because the idea is that every airplane is just like that first one that was approved.
An aircraft fuselage is like a giant tube. That tube is made up of interlocking semicircular parts called cords. Put together, they form the frame around which every other part of the airframe is built and on which the external skin is assembled. Exit doorways and cargo hatches are weak points in this fuselage. To strengthen them, huge reinforcing sheets called bear straps are assembled round the holes. According to Boeing's own documentation for the 737 NG, cords and bear straps are primary structural elements. parts which are critical to the plane's ability to fly safely.
The failure of PSEs could result in the catastrophic failure of the airplane.
These are the parts of airplanes that if they fail, we can have catastrophic events. We can have a decompression at altitude, or we can have a rupture in the vessel, in the fuselage vessel of the aircraft. As long as we can make that hold together, we can keep the passengers safe.
Boeing subcontracted the manufacture of these critical parts to a company called AHF Ducommun in Gardena, California. Each cord and bear strap for the 737NG was to be built here on giant computer-controlled tools, a process called CNC.
Hi there, I'm Captain Jim Thomas. I'm the 737 Fleet Training Manager for American Airlines, and I'd like to welcome you aboard our brand new 737 airplane.
And from the start of 1997, airlines across the world put the new plane into service.
It's going to be a great airplane to fly, and I look forward to flying with you on an American Airlines flight very soon.
These are Boeing's primary assembly factories in Wichita. It was here that Boeing assembled the parts from AHF Ducommun onto the 737NG airframes. And here, in 1998, that G.G. Pruitt first discovered problems with those parts.
The minute that I took the desk of buying 737 next generation parts, I had shop personnel coming to me, talking to me about the problems and the issues that they were having with the parts not being manufactured accurately.
The affected parts were both bear straps and cords, critical primary structural elements of the 737NG fuselage.
One of the shop managers sent me email saying that they were having problems with the fail-safe cords, which are the long ribs that go all the way around the aircraft. Well, they go halfway around and then they join up to the ribs that come up from the bottom. And were telling me that from the beginning of the 1996 timeframe when they started manufacturing these parts, that they were coming in with shy edge margins, they were out of contour.
Boeing's internal documents, which we have obtained, give a snapshot of the scale of the problem.
Part out of contour, quantity 1.
Part width, oversized, quantity 4.
Material thin, quantity 6.
Part undercut, quantity 26.
Hole mislocated, quantity 17.
They also show the source of the problem, AHF Ducommun. But according to Boeing staff, the company rejected only a handful of these defective parts. The rest were assembled onto the aircraft.
We were putting our foot down and not going to participate in allowing non-conforming parts to come in and be put on planes. But one of the managers wrote an email and said, "This is stupid. There's already 300 of these out there on planes. Why would we scrap them now?" So they used them. They put them on planes.
Under pressure from its own staff, in early 2000, Boeing agreed to send a multidisciplinary audit team to the Ducommun manufacturing plant. Its mission was to discover why Ducommun was delivering such bad parts. That journey was the start of an investigation which would change the lives of G.G. Pruitt and Taylor Smith forever.
We went out to the supplier to help them to make good parts, but they didn't want our help. In fact, their quality manager told us that they were going to stick 24 bear straps that we scrapped up a part of our body. It was very shocking that they would even talk to Boeing like that, because we were Boeing. I was the one buying the parts.
And what the investigators found inside the Ducommun plant shocked them profoundly, particularly the state of the critical computerized manufacturing tools.
It was atrocious what we found, really. The tools, a lot of them were just in piles here and there. They couldn't find a lot of them. They were treated horribly. And they're tools that are used to make these big parts that go on the airplane have to be designed. They have to be kept properly. They have to be maintained. They have to be calibrated. And Ducommun had no records to show any of that.
Instead of using the computerized manufacturing process set out in the 737NG's licensed design, the investigators discovered that Ducommun was cutting and building the parts by hand.
It was overwhelming
what we saw. We took pictures because we knew no one would ever believe us. They literally took the template that they had and scribed with a magic marker on the material. Then took a hand cutter and cut where the magic marker was.
And they would take hand saws and saw the material off, and then the hand sander, and they would sand it down to as close as they could to this magic marker line. And then they would just come along and drill holes by hand that were supposed to be the ATA holes, which were very closely toleranced. We're supposed to make this airplane fit together so easily. There is no way that they could have done it correctly.
People say, okay, so what? Well, the parts were bad. Now, these aircraft are flying at 30, 35,000 feet. They're flying with 150 people on board. They're flying over long durations of water. It can't just pull over if there's a problem.
But there was worse to come. When the Boeing team asked to examine the documents, which were legally required to detail exactly how each part was made, they discovered that Ducommun appeared to have falsified these planning records.
Ducommun handed us planning when we first came in there to look at, so that we could look at what tools were listed and how the parts were manufactured. And that planning said that they did it on the NC machines. But when we went into the shop to look at how they were actually manufacturing parts, the shop trackers said that they were making them by hand.
So are you saying there were two sets of books?
Yes.
We have obtained sworn testimony by Ducommun's director of engineering. According to this, only a fraction of the parts it made for the 737NG were built by the approved computer-controlled processes.
I sat everybody around the table saying there's not enough NC machines in the world, nor are there enough CMMs to check these kinds of parts. 10% of them stayed on the machine. Maybe it was a little greater than that, but not much more.
The Boeing investigators believed that building these high-precision parts by hand completely violated the official type approval for the 737NG and made every aircraft using them potentially unsafe.
This is the entire skeleton of the 737NG. This is not just one thing that's holding another thing together. It's every fail-safe cord that goes from the beginning of the airplane to the end of the airplane. And when something happens, it's not only a failure of the one part, it cascades. So one part fails, it transmits stress to another part. Before you know it, the entire airplane fails.
But Ducommun seemed remarkably unworried.
They told us Boeing knew about it. And they also told one of our auditors to stay away from all of us because we were going to be shot. They had long arms that went deep into Boeing, and this would go nowhere.
What did you understand by them saying you're going to be shot?
I really didn't know what to understand. I mean, at that point, it was like, are you serious? Are you talking a physical threat? Are you talking, you know, we're going to lose our jobs? What are they actually referring to? So we reported it to corporate internal audit. I felt it was a huge red flag that a supplier felt so confident to tell a team of 14 people from Boeing that they were going to be shot. Makes you wonder.
The special investigation continues in just a moment with more disturbing revelations about the use of faulty parts and the shocking reaction when Boeing's employees started demanding an inquiry.
We had great hope that would be done.
But what happened next would shake their faith. Not just in the safety of the 737NG, but in the US government itself.
There was one person recovered yesterday out of the area that we're searching now. When the tsunami struck Japan, Britain sent a search and rescue team to face the devastation. Join those who put their safety on the line.
And then the building started shaking. That was quite a surreal experience.
And bravely helped those in desperate need.
That hope is the thing that keeps you going and keeps you more determined to keep searching and searching and searching.
Tsunami Search and Rescue, tonight 9:30 on SBS One.
When do you first notice how much you love your mum? You know you always have. But when you were younger, you couldn't really explain it. Then you got a little older, and you could put it into words, but not always the right ones.
I hate you!
Then came that moment you found out you could have lost her.
Mum?
And the last thing you needed were the right words.
Today's fast-moving world needs a whole new level of power. Energizer Ultimate Lithium. The world's longest-lasting AA battery and high-tech devices now last even longer.
Sweet, sweet memories you gave of me. You can't beat the memories you gave of me.
One girl, one boy, some grief, some joy, memories.
When you just want to get your life back to normal, we're committed to help.
Have you ever had a moment when you realise someone's health is all that matters? Now's your chance to tell them. Go to hbfmoments.com.au.
Welcome back. Now to the second part of our special investigation into aircraft safety. When two Boeing employees first discovered that a subcontractor was providing the company with faulty parts, they couldn't believe what they were seeing. But, as Tim Tate reports, when they took their concerns to Boeing management, they got another shock.
The investigation team returned to Wichita in the summer of 2000. They reported what they'd found at Ducommun to Boeing's management.
I expected my management to be as shocked and appalled as I was, because the technical issues that were, and the quality issues that we found on those particular parts that Ducommun was manufacturing, could very well have caused catastrophic failure in an aircraft.
We have obtained a draft of an internal Boeing memorandum written by its internal affairs managers after the investigation team had completed the audit at Ducommun. Its warnings about the problems there to be sent to the company's most senior executives were stark.
The integrity of AHF Ducommun as a partnered supplier places the Boeing company at risk. Immediately cease all new business activity with AHF Ducommun and consider disengagement.
Boeing refuses to discuss this memorandum or what action it took on its warnings. But on the shop floor, the problems continued, and Gigi Pruitt witnessed Boeing workers taking dangerous shortcuts to make the faulty parts fit.
The woman who was doing the assembly that I was following put the next part on it, the holes didn't meet up, so she re-drilled holes to attach where it needed to be. And we asked her, why are you not writing a non-conformance record and making the supplier accountable? She said, my manager won't let me. If I reject all the parts that come in that aren't lining up with the ATA, then we're gonna shut down the line and I've gotta make rate.
She also watched other Boeing assembly workers taking it on themselves to disguise the problems with the ill-fitting parts.
They shimmed and filled at the top and sprayed it green And the guy that we were talking to in the shop said, they'll never know. Looks like the same part. It looks great.
And when that didn't work, the assembly line staff forced the parts together, even beating them with steel hammers.
There are records that show that the parts were hammered into position in some cases. You bend a part enough, you beat it enough, it's going to put stresses in it. It's more likely to crack, and it's more likely to corrode.
The Federal Aviation Administration has given Boeing delegated authority, essentially trusting it to police its own processes in return for an undertaking that it will voluntarily report any problem to the regulator. But Boeing's investigators say that the company refused to do so.
So we went to Security Investigations Director and we said, in the agreement you have with the FAA, you're to self-disclose any nonconformance issues. And they're going to give you grace, and they're going to work with you, and they're not going to beat you up, and it's going to be out on the table, and we're going to make sure that planes are safe that are already flying. And we were told, if you go and tell anyone, Boeing could sue you.
How did that make you feel?
Very scared. It was like a threat. And I really took offense to being threatened by my own company for trying to be ethical and for trying to protect the American public, basically.
The Boeing investigators now faced an agonizing choice: protecting themselves or turning whistleblower to protect the flying public.
I couldn't understand how come our management really didn't want to know these things. Boeing makes a lot of money, and they're supposedly the premier aircraft of the world. You know, that's what we lived by. We're Boeing. We make great aircraft. And so you would expect that safety would be one of the number one things that they would look at.
We have hundreds of planes flying out there. So where do we stand? What do we do? What's our responsibility to society? No longer our responsibility to this company. What's our responsibility to society? And at that point, there was a core group of us who said, what direction do we go?
The U.S. Department of Justice is responsible for protecting whistleblowers. In the spring of 2002, Gigi Pruitt and Taylor Smith took their concerns to Washington.
We actually met with the government and told them our story, and they had the same reaction as most people do when they hear our story to begin with, and they're shocked and appalled. We will protect you. The Department of Justice told us, we'll protect you. We will not let you be retaliated against. We will keep you safe.
We were assured that our identity would be kept protected. It was under seal, and that no one would tell Boeing who we were. The FAA would do an investigation to find out what could be done to secure the safety. We had great hope that would be done.
But what happened next would shake their faith, not just in the safety of the 737NG, but in the whole system of aircraft regulation and in the US government itself. Parts of the FAA investigation carried out in 2002 have been released under the Freedom of Information Act. The documents have been partly redacted by the FAA. But the only investigative actions recorded in these publicly viewable documents are that the FAA looked up the address of the company which made the faulty parts, AHF Ducommun, and visited Ducommun's website.
The investigation by the FAA was laughable. It was really laughable. And they concluded at the end of it, without really any apparent consideration of the engineering requirements, the manufacturing requirements, the manufacturing data, the tag or nonconformity history of the aircraft, they concluded that there was not a problem, closed the investigation.
With nowhere left to turn, in 2005 the whistleblowers went to court, filing suit against Boeing and Ducommun. By then, their identities had been leaked to Boeing. Both of them lost their jobs.
I felt very betrayed. You know, you expect the government to be for the citizens and for the safety of the people, but apparently they're more concerned about the big business than they are about us.
Earlier this year, the whistleblowers once again approached the FAA. A conference was set up, but once again, the FAA seemed completely uninterested.
If there was a single question asked by any of the FAA people, I don't remember it. In that short conversation, one of our technical experts put on, gave a little presentation to them, and silence on the other end.
Dr. Michael Dreikorn was one of the whistleblowers' experts. A former FAA official and a highly respected aircraft safety engineer, he is shocked by the FAA's reluctance to investigate the problem thoroughly.
My perception of what I used to consider my friends in the FAA is that they are ignoring this problem because it's too big to be true. These non-conforming parts are like a virus in our body. If we allow the virus to go unchecked, it's going to manifest itself in a catastrophic failure and it's going to kill a lot of people.
To your knowledge, has the FAA itself examined any of these parts?
No.
Has it asked anyone else to examine these parts?
No.
But the whistleblowers' experts found evidence of serious stress problems in the 737NG parts. And they found it in the FAA's own files. The FAA maintains a database of service difficulty reports, warnings from airlines about problems they have discovered during routine maintenance. A snapshot sample of these SDRs from a handful of airlines revealed highly advanced level 2 corrosion occurring in the key 737NG structural parts, cords and bear straps, and in aircraft less than 8 years old.
Now, I personally performed an analysis of the FAA's service difficulty reporting database, and what I was expecting to see is a couple of cracks, a couple of corrosion issues, but no, I'm finding significant volumes of cracking and corrosion on these parts, which are our primary structural elements.
In the past 3 years, there has been a series of accidents involving 737NGs. Three of them seem to indicate problems with the key structural parts of the aircraft. On February the 25th, 2009, 9 people died when a Turkish Airlines 737NG overshot the runway at Amsterdam Schiphol Airport. On December the 23rd, 2009, 40 passengers were injured when an American Airlines 737NG overshot the runway at Kingston Airport, Jamaica. And on August the 17th, 2010, when a 737NG operated by the Colombian airline Aeris also overshot the runway at the Holiday Island of San Andres, one passenger died and dozens were injured. In all three accidents, the aircraft were 8 years old, the age at which serious problems of corrosion and cracking have been recorded. Each aircraft broke into three pieces. According to the whistleblowers' experts, each broke at exactly the same points on their fuselage, and, they say, at each of these points, the faulty Ducommun parts had been installed.
The airplane's not designed to fall apart like that. It should have absorbed that stress, and the people that were slightly injured wouldn't have been injured.
The aircraft should not have broken up, in your view?
Absolutely should not.
We have obtained footage of a test crash conducted by the FAA in 1984. It shows the extraordinary strength of an aircraft whose parts hadn't been ill-formed, pre-stressed, or badly fitted. The FAA flew a remotely controlled Boeing 707 into the floor of the Mojave Desert to see what happens to a fuselage on impact. Although it hit the ground at much higher speeds than the 737 NGs in Amsterdam, Jamaica, and Colombia, its fuselage remained intact. We asked the FAA a series of specific questions about its investigations into the problems with 737 NGs. It refused to answer them, but it issued a statement saying that it had no reason to believe there is a safety problem with the 737 NG parts, and that even if they failed, the failure would not affect the continued safe flight and landing of the aircraft.
On the record, this is the videotaped deposition.
This man is Robert Easton, the FAA's chief scientific and technical advisor. At the suggestion of the Department of Justice, he has just filed a sworn declaration, giving the Boeing 737 NG a clean bill of health.
Based on the evidence I reviewed, there was not enough information, well, there's not any data to make a determination that there was an unsafe condition.
And most surprising of all, the video of this hearing captures Mr. Easton admitting that he hadn't written his sworn statement exonerating Boeing. Instead, it was largely written by Boeing's lawyer, Steve Coe.
As I recall, the first draft came from Mr. Cole, and when I reviewed it, I believe I did not change that.
Boeing's lawyers met with him, drafted his statement that he then signed.
How can a company which is being investigated by the FAA draft a clean bill of health from the FAA for that company?
Well, when I was pulled over for a ticket a little bit ago for going 10 miles over the speed limit, I kind of wanted to draft my own ticket too. The cop didn't let me do that.
I am very seriously concerned about a catastrophic cabin failure, structural failure at altitude. And I think it would be a 737 NG, and it will lose its ability to stay together, and unfortunately will be a smoking hole in the ground.
For 10 years, the Boeing whistleblowers have fought to prevent that smoking hole from happening, whatever the personal cost.
So do you draw a line in the sand and say, I'm going to die being a Boeing employee, loyal to them, covering up, and who knows how many people put their lives at risk flying on planes? Or do I draw the line in the sand and say, you know what? I have to be able to live with myself and know that I did the right thing, no matter what it costs.
That report by Tim Tate from Al Jazeera English. And both Qantas and Virgin Australia have 737s in their fleet built during the period detailed in that report. Neither airline has plans to take any special action at this point. They told us they stand by their safety checks and will follow any relevant directives issued by aviation authorities. Up next, an intriguing murder mystery in the West Bank sparks a culture war. We'll be right back.